Hey friends, and welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, welcome. My name is Kait. I'm all about living a faithful motherhood and a purposeful life, and a lot of the content here is about foster care and adoption. I'm a huge advocate for it. I believe it's a global responsibility to step up for vulnerable children, especially as Christians, and I'm just here to advocate for that and get people more informed about foster care and adoption and the system and how things work, and to support and encourage those who are already on this journey. If you're new here, I'd love for you to subscribe and join the amazing community of mamas here. Today we're going to be talking about what the social worker wishes you knew as a foster parent. And to get to this video, I did a lot of research, I asked a lot of questions to social worker friends, people that have commented on Instagram posts or whatnot that they're social workers, people I've just met through creating this community, and a lot of the things are the same. I also got a lot of, like, that's just a really full question. I don't even know how to answer that comments, but I wanted to kind of round up what was kind of the resounding things that social workers want us to know as foster parents. So first and foremost, what social workers want foster parents to know is you are the healthiest person on the team of people that they have to work with. So when you feel like you're not being heard or you're not getting your answers quick enough or things like that, you are, and not to put it this way because no social worker said it this way, but you are the lowest on the totem pole because you are most likely stable, you know, unhappy with a case decision or whatever it may be, but you are not in crisis. So social workers deal with families in crisis, and as a foster parent, that is not you. So you are the least worrisome on their caseload. So they want you to just know that and take it from their perspective that, you know, other people that they're dealing with, there's often dangerous situations, crisis situations, scary situations, situations where they're dealing with courts and lawyers and time sensitive things for their supervisors or, you know, for court paper documents, that sort of thing. So it's not that they don't want to get back to you. You're just the least urgent, if that makes sense. So a lot of them said, I wish foster parents understood our perspective. Another thing they want you to know is that they are in it to help children, but some of them do become numb to it over the years. And it's a really, really hard job. Burnout is real. I'm sure if you've worked in any capacity in the system as a foster parent, as a worker, you know that people move around a lot. It is really hard to see child neglect, child abuse, deal with broken families all of the time on that level when you are often their number one support person. It's really difficult. So burnout is real, and they certainly don't get into it for the money. It is a well-paying job here in Canada, but it's certainly not a high-paying job. But social workers get in it because they want to help people. Another comment I got from a worker was they work in more than just child services. They're not just apprehending children and taking away children. They could be working in a counseling role, like a guidance counselor at a school, therapy roles. There's lots of ways, I think, that when people hear social worker, they often kind of automatically go to children's aid services, but there's lots of other ways that social workers work and can work in different capacities. And often if they do start out in the child welfare system, they can move on to, I don't want to use easier, but different roles. The trauma that you're seeing doesn't affect you quite as much. So I got a few comments about that a lot of people start in child welfare, but there's a whole other realm of possibilities for social work. This one I got, and this one is deals with a lot of families where she has to apprehend children, and she said, I'm not a child snatcher. And I hate that term, but often when you have your child apprehended from you, you have a very negative outlook on the social worker, that person who's actually doing it. And they are in the best interest of the children. They are not child snatchers. They are not doing this for any other reason other than to keep that child safe. And of course, when there's mental health and addictions and all other things, the perspective of the biological family is often skewed, but they don't like that term being called child snatchers. I got a few people that said that. A couple people saying that it's not as easy as most people think, as foster parents think. A lot of foster parents think that it's just a lot of paperwork and they're just another caseload and that's why they're not doing their job efficiently. There's so much more than just casework. There's so much more than paperwork. They could be out on a home visit. They could be doing counseling. They could be in court. They could be doing research. They could be spending time with a couple who's adopting, or they could be spending time trying to reunify a family. There is so many facets to their job. So it's not just about paperwork. Another thing that a few social workers said is their job is a lot more dangerous than you think. And I had one girl share a story, and she ended up leaving child welfare because it was such a dangerous situation. She had to go and remove the children, and a biological father pulled a gun on her, and the police weren't there. She was there by herself, and it caused a lot of trauma for her, and she ended up having to leave the child welfare system. Their job can be very dangerous, and sometimes you have to intervene when children's safety are involved and the police aren't there yet, things like that. You might be the first on the scene. So I don't think that's common that you are the first on the scene, and I think that it's wise to wait for police, but sometimes when kids' safety are involved, they have to step in and take some really dangerous positions. So their job isn't very safe. They don't work just 9 to 5. I think this is something that I have kind of taking the perspective of, like, if we're not in business hours, it doesn't matter to them kind of thing, which I have to take back because now that I know social workers a little more personally and just know the ins and outs of their job a little bit better, they work often around the clock and they're meeting with clients, they're meeting with foster parents after hours, they're not doing necessarily the 9 to 5. Yes, they usually start off with good vacation time, but their job is much more than the 9 to 5. There can be weekends involved, there can be early mornings, there can be evenings involved. They have to do what our agency calls duty work. So they'll be on duty for when a children's worker isn't available to apprehend. There's always a duty worker if there's an emergency that comes up, and there's after hours overnight. Children's welfare gets called at all hours of the night. So often they have to work overnight shifts. So it's definitely not a 9 to 5 job. Another thing I got is that they wish the foster parents knew more, even though they can't share it, because it would give them more perspective on their case. I had people share if they knew the kind of abuse and neglect that they had to see on a day in and day out basis, the foster parents would understand that their little problem of not hearing back till the next day, you know, an extra business day, is really not that big in the grand scheme of things. And this really kind of coincided with, if your heart isn't in this, and then it isn't for you, because this is a job that takes heart, that takes soul, that takes seeing a lot of hard things, that takes way too many caseloads and in way too little hours. Social workers are constantly overworked and underpaid for their services, and your heart has to be in it. So like a foster parent isn't making money off of this, social workers, yes, it's a job for them, so they are making an income. You have to have the heart to do it. You have to have a heart for these children. And like I said in the beginning, social worker burnout is real, and many people have to leave the job, not because they don't have the heart for it, but because their heart is so big and they can only see the abuse and neglect for so long without it affecting them personally. Social workers talk to me about post-traumatic stress disorder, that they've been diagnosed with that they've been diagnosed with job burnout, and they've had to take sick leaves and things like that, because it is a hard job. It's not an easy job, and your heart definitely has to be in it. So if you're a foster parent listening to this and you have a difficult social worker, just try and look at things from their perspective. Try and think and imagine what they might have seen that day, or what they might have had to dealt with, or what sort of deadlines or another kid's caseload got added on their already full load, and just try to look at it from their perspective. Any job, social workers, there's good ones and there's bad ones. I've had amazing, phenomenal social workers that you can tell really care. Oh, little man's up. Who can tell really care and really put their heart into it. And I've had social workers that I can't get a hold of, that don't get back to me unless I go to their supervisor, that just seem angry with me and like I'm annoying them. So I think there's definitely a healthy balance in being a good social worker. But as foster parents, I think we need to take so much pressure off of them and realize that we are the place of safety. We are the least of their concerns. If it's really urgent, they're going to get back to you. They have to get back to you. It's their job. If it's not, you can go above their head to supervisors, but that doesn't do anything in building a positive relationship between the two of you. So just to give them a little bit more grace and a little bit more patience was kind of the overwhelming, resounding advice or input that I got from social workers. So I hope you learned something from this. I hope you go a little bit easier on your social workers. If any of my social workers are watching this over the years, I have had amazing social workers, and I appreciate you, and I appreciate the work you do so much. I especially appreciate the ones that check in on me when they know I'm going through a tough situation as a foster parent, or when they just stay in touch on a regular basis and I'm not having to chase them down as a foster parent. That's what I appreciate in a social worker. But it is a team effort. You have to work with these people. You're part of the team. So keep their perspective in mind whenever you're getting frustrated that you haven't heard back from somebody. I know I have been there 100%. There's definitely a lot of frustration that comes up when a social worker seems to not pay you any attention when you just want a simple answer. But just know their caseloads are very full. The things they see are very hard, and you are the safest person in the equation of who they all work with on a day-to-day basis. Thank you guys so much for watching. I appreciate you being here. If you know a social worker, give them a hug or give them a phone call, write them a thank you note, buy them a coffee, just show them a token of your appreciation for the thankless work that they do day in and day out. I would love for you to subscribe if you're new to the channel and you care about anything that I just said. You care about vulnerable children, orphan care, being a foster parent, being the best mom that you can be, you know, living with purpose, living for the Lord. If any of those things resonate with you, I would love to have you subscribe and join us. Like this video, it helps other like-minded mamas to find my channel, and I will see you guys on the next one. Bye.